questions. So the, as I mentioned in the last lesson, the usually we call this chi 2 as the nonlinear coefficient. And to get the full understanding about this nonlinear coefficient, we have to use the matrix with the three index ijk. And as I mentioned, ijk could be the x, y, and the three components. And also that I mentioned that if we want to decide all the elements for this the chi 2, we need a lot of experiments and to decide. And fortunately, we have the symmetric crystals, the symmetric property. So in other words, when we use the operation of symmetry of the crystal, and this chi 2 should be the same because the material doesn't change. And as a result, by using this symmetric property of the chi 2, we can significantly reduce the number of the chi 2. Actually, we can even find some elements must be zero. And in fact, for the chi 2, if you have a crystal with the central symmetric, and this chi 2 must be zero, it's very easy because when we use the central operation, and in other words, we change the sign of the electric field, and the crystal should be the same. The responses from the crystal should be the same. In other words, the chi 2, we can easily get the chi 2 and the z, and chi 2, and we change the sign of the direction of the electric field that you applied, and these two should be the same. And as a result, the chi 2 must be equal to minus chi 2. So that there's only one possibility, that means chi 2 must be zero. Okay then. So in other words, if you want to obtain the second order, use the second order nonlinear entity of the crystal, the crystal cannot have the central symmetric property. Okay then. So this is just an example to show you how to simplify this chi 2 using the crystal symmetry property. And also, I mentioned in the last lesson that by using the chi 2, we can develop some phase modulators based on the Pockels effect or EO effect. And I promise to give you the rough idea on how to get or to calculate the response of this the Pockels device. And to just give you the outline, the guideline on how to obtain the response of the DC or DC-like electric field and to get the EO device. Basically, you applied the external DC-like electric field, or you can apply the voltage across the crystal. And then this electric field will result a change of refractive index of the material. Because as I mentioned, this refractive index is a function of electric field you applied, and due to the second order nonlinear effect. Okay, then. And this change of the refractive index will result in the change of the phase of the light passing through the crystal. So this is very important. We mentioned that our target is to achieve a pi phase shift. Why pi phase shift? The reason is like this. You have a crystal, for example, okay, then. And this is the simple term example, the interferometer. If you apply, say, the electric field on one of this the interferometer arms, then you see that you introduce the phase difference between two arms. If the phase difference between two arms, theta phi, is equal to pi, then basically you can manipulate the output from this interferometer from 0 to 1. 0-1 is very important because you want to generate a digital signal. Okay, now. So this is why we are targeting the pi phase shift. And I mentioned yesterday that to achieve the pi phase shift, we also need to consider that how high the voltage you can apply. You need to apply to achieve the pi phase shift. And I gave you two examples. And one is non-digital, another is transverse the modulator yesterday. And you found that by proper design, or by using the proper configuration of the device, you can achieve the pi phase shift with only several volts of voltage. And this is a practical device, as I mentioned, And this phase, this optical modulator is widely used in the telecommunication system currently. So this is a brief review, summary of what we learned in the last lesson. And also, I want to mention that, since you have a chi-2 here, and you have three index, and usually the people prefer to use a simplified the notation for chi-2. So in other words, we can apply so-called contraction rule to replace this three index of the chi-2 with the two index of chi-2. And we just say to make a rule about ourselves. So basically, the rule is like this. You have xy. xx, you replace by 1. Get that? And yy, you replace it by 2. And zz, replace it by 3. Okay, that? And furthermore, you have yz, and this comes to 4. And the xz, and 5, and then xy, 6. Okay, then. So by using this the replacement, and basically we indicate the x, x1, and for this k index, the x corresponds to 1, y, 2, and z corresponds to 3. Okay, then you see that we can generate a sort of a progress coefficient matrix. And in the case of the Lisnavich, I can give you the example of this Lisnavich, which is given by the 0 minus R22 and the R13. And this, the second row is the 1, R22, and R13. And third is the 0, 0, R33. And fourth is 1, R51, and 0, and R51. 0 and 0 and then minus R12 0 0. So as you can see that we can greatly simplify the gamma of the R matrix or progress coefficient matrix. And this is very important because by using this the simplified the matrix, we can easily calculate the change of the refract index due to applied the electric field. So we use two examples. For example, let's take the second example we used yesterday. Okay, in this example, we applied the electric field along the z direction. Okay, in other words, x component and y component is 0. Okay, so this is the electric field you applied. Then we have to consider the response of light wave. This is the second electric field. And we can define the change of the B parameter. By using this equation. Then basically, if you know the electric field, and if you know the EO, the focus coefficient, in principle, you should be able to obtain the change of B parameter. And the B parameter, as I mentioned, is linked to the index ellipsoid, which is given by this equation. Okay, and I mentioned the definition of B parameter. So we see that by using this equation, you can easily obtain the change of refract index of the crystal. And by using the, if you know the change of refract index, then you should be able to obtain the change of the phase of light after passing through the crystal. So this is the general the procedure to achieve the, to calculate the change of the refract index and the phase of the device. Okay. So this is what we learned in the last lesson. And in today, I'm going to continue this discussion and give you some idea on the other non-linear effect. So today, basically, this is the main content I'm going to cover today. The first thing I'm going to introduce is the second harmonic generation. Even though this is the well-known phenomenon, non-linear phenomenon, but I think that to understand this phenomenon thoroughly, will be very helpful to understand the other non-linear process. And if I have time, I will cover the sub-frequency generation and the difference between generation and some application as well. So the main idea, basically the key idea is to give you some basic idea on the nonlinear optics and they give you some idea on the application, the potential application of the nonlinear devices. So let's start from the first part, the second harmonic generator. So this is the first experiment on the second harmonic generation, the report in 1962. And if you look at this setup, you will find that all the necessary components of the key ideas are all included in this setup. First, you need the light source. And as I mentioned, you usually need a laser beam to obtain the nonlinear effect. The simple reason is because the laser beam has a much higher electric field strength. Okay, and you need a very strong input. And laser beam is the first the requirement. Secondly, you need the lens in this case. So why lens? Because lens can focus the light into small area. So yesterday, I didn't mention, but it's very important. To measure the light, you have the two parameters, the intensity and the power. And the relationship between the intensity and power is given like this. The power is given by the intensity times the cross-section of light beam, if the light beam is uniform. Okay, and as you can see from here, if you have a very large area of the beam size, okay, and the intensity could be small, but the power could be large. Okay, however, from the nonlinear optics point of view, what we are interested in is the intensity, not the power. Okay, because large intensity will give you the high electric field, as I mentioned. Okay, so therefore, using the lens is necessary, or is important in this case. Okay, and then we need a nonlinear crystal. So in this case, we use the quartz, the experiment use the quartz crystal as a nonlinear medium. Then we have the new light waves, which is indicated here. This is the input wavelength, the fundamental wavelength. This is the new wavelength, or second harmonic curve. And also we need to find the so-called phase matching condition. So phase matching condition is the most important concept in nonlinear optics. So I'm going to spend more time on how to achieve the phase matching condition and what is the phase matching condition. I will explain later. Okay, so just recall your memory. So to solve the nonlinear problems, nonlinear optics problems, basically we start from the Maxwell equation, which is exactly the same that we learned yesterday. And this is the second order partial differential equation, and we try to solve the electric field. Okay, and to consider the nonlinear optics, you only need to replace this nonlinear term with a different effect you want to focus on. And if we assume that we are using we're considering the single wavelength as an input, then we can assume that the second order nonlinear curve is given by this equation. As I mentioned, the chi 2 should be the matrix, okay, and tensor matrix. And to the assumption of the plane wave, I introduced the concept of plane wave. Okay, and under the assumption of the slowly varying the amplitude approximation, which is true in most cases, we can simplify the Maxwell equation and into these couple of equations. And maybe I should say a couple words about the slowly varying the amplitude approximation. So slowly varying the approximation is given like this. So you have a laser beam shine into the crystal nonlinear medium. And we assume that the nonlinear coefficient or nonlinear response curve is very small. In other words, the change of the nonlinear the signal is very slow. This is a very reasonable assumption. This is true in most cases. And this assumption, as I mentioned, we can simplify the second order the nonlinear equation into the first order partial differential equation. This is very important because this is the first step for us to obtain the analytic of the solution. Okay, and if you look at this couple equations, you'll find that E1, E2 could be the input, could be your input. Okay, because if you recall your memory, you have Chi2, E, and E1, and E2. So this actually is contributes to the nonlinear signal. As a result, the E1 and E2 could be the input. And the E3 is new generation signal. Okay, so this is the nonlinear signal, defense thinking this way. And if E1 and E2 are the same, so basically you have only one input. And this could be the second harmonic generation or the other the parameter down conversion. I will cover the come back to this back later on. Okay. And anyway, so the E1, E2 could be the same. And if you look at this couple of equations, you'll find that all these three electric fields are coupled with each other. You can't simply say that solve one equation without considering the others. Okay. So this is the characteristic of the coupled equation. And also in all these coupled equations, you have a delta k term. Okay. K is the propagation constant, and which is given by this equation, because this is very important to write down to that here. The delta k is given by k3 minus k2 and minus k1. Okay, and in other words, it's given by that. So if you look at this delta k expression, okay, you'll find that delta k is related to your wavelength and is related to refracting index. So as I mentioned, refracting index of the material plays a very, very important role in nonlinear optics. Okay. So in other words, you have to find the condition so that this delta k be zero, ideally. Okay, so this is our target. Okay, how to obtain the delta k zero with the greatest effect, the optical signal or the nonlinear signal. I'll come back to this point later on. So anyway, this delta k is called the phase mismatching. And our target is to reduce this phase mismatching as small as possible. And of course, we can make some assumptions to obtain the simplified solution. For example, if we consider the second harmonic generation, in other words, E1 and E2 are the same, then the coupling equation is simplified in this way. Okay, there's still the two equations there. We need to solve these two equations. And of course, we can first make the assumption that we assume that the fundamental light will not change, the power will not change. Okay, the non-depletion assumption. So in this case, we have only need to solve the first equation, the first order differential equation. Okay, then, because in this case, E omega is a constant. Okay, then, so in the first equation, you have only the one variable, E2 omega, which is the harmonic generation signal. Then you can easily obtain the electric field at the second harmonic. You can obtain the power of the second harmonic generation signal by using this simplified expression. So this is the analytical solution. Okay, so I'm not going to go too in deeper into the mathematical derivation here, but I do want to explain physically what does this solution mean. Okay, so in this solution, you can see that if you want to obtain large second harmonic generation signal, what do you need to do? First, L is the device length. You want to choose a longer device. Okay, because this the longer device, the larger the power, SH power that you can obtain. Okay, so this is the device length is a very important rule. And also you have to find so-called the phase matching condition. Delta k is zero, because if you find the delta k is zero, phase matching condition, then this term become one. Okay, so otherwise this the signal will oscillate whenever they increase dramatically with the increase of the device length. So this is the second condition. So I summarize here. The device length is one thing you need to consider, and the delta k phase magic is the second thing you need to consider. And the third thing is the power of your input, the fundamental power. Okay, the larger the fundamental power, the larger the SH signal you can obtain. Actually, if you look at the A is a cross section of fundamental power. So in other words, you want to incite the very large intensity of your fundamental light. So if you recall your memory, I just mentioned today on the experiment, then you need a lens usually to increase the intensity of your fundamental power. Okay, and also the very importantly, this is a term of the Kaiju. Okay, so this Kaiju basically this is the direction of the electric field or polarization direction of the second harmonic signal, and this is the polarization direction of the fundamental light. Okay, so in other words, you have to choose a proper configuration of your crystal so that the largest component of Kaiju can be used. So if you recall your memory, I mentioned yesterday that in the case of the missing nabit, Kai-3-3, okay, of the 3-3 component, has the largest component. It's the largest component. In other words, you should find a condition in the case of the missing nabit so that the fundamental light position is along the z direction, and the second harmonic signal light also has a position along the z direction. Okay, so you see, this equation basically gives all the requirements of the how to obtain the height of the second harmonic generation. So the third last condition is we call this a effectiveness. In the case of the second harmonic generation, people usually use D instead of Chi2. Okay, so the D effect is very important. So we call this term as a D effect. Okay, so these are basically the four conditions we need to optimize so that the large SHG signal can be obtained. So before I move forward, I would like to give you some idea on how to use this the second harmonic generation and what kind of applications we can obtain. So to do so, I want to show you one slide here. Okay, so basically, the second harmonic generation give us a tool to obtain a shorter wavelength. So basically, the idea is that you incident the omega signal and achieve the 2 omega signal. So in the wavelength, you launch into the wavelength and you obtain the half wavelength. Okay, so this is basically the basic function of the SHG device. Okay, and the one application of this device is basically to obtain visible light. And as you know, even though the semiconductor laser diode technology has advanced significantly these days, but if you look at the spectrum of the wavelengths available from semiconductor laser diode, it's very limited. Okay, that. And on the other hand, for display application, we need three basic colors, okay, the primary color, red, green, and blue. Okay, the red color basically that people are looking at 630s, and green basically the 5032, and blue somehow 450s around. So these are the best colors that people are looking for, because by using this color wavelength, you can achieve the largest the color gamut, and in other words, you can get much richer the color. And to do so, if you look at these three wavelengths, the red could be made by the semiconductor laser diode, but blue is available, but still expensive. Okay, so let's say put a small question mark here. So might be able to use the semiconductor laser, but green definitely the at this moment, no green semiconductor laser available on the market, and significant efforts and the investment have been done for a number of years, but still not successful yet. So, in other words, if you want to achieve the laser display, you miss one important color. Okay, and however, if you use the second harmonic generation technique, this color can easily be achieved, because if you want to achieve the 532, you only need the 1064 nanometers light, which is widely available for ND Young laser. Or the ND to the Y mu 4 laser. Okay. So this is the widely available commercially available laser. So in other words, by using the second harmonic generation the technique, you can achieve this laser, the green laser. And these are the two important applications by using the second harmonic device. The first application is laser TV. If you come from the state, I think maybe you saw this laser TV on the market already. So it was sold only in the States from last Christmas. And this is a 65-inch laser TV with much better color and much lighter, much less the power consumption. Okay, so the total power consumption of this big screen laser, high-definition laser TV is only 200 watts. Okay, so you can imagine how much energy you can save. And also the color is 2 times better than the current available LCD and plasma TV. And another application is so-called pico projector or micro projector. The basic idea is you integrate your projector and with the cell phone function. So in the future, I think in 2 or 3 years, you will see this pico projector on the market. It will be widely used, and I personally think that this is a very interesting market and maybe the result of the revolution the technology development. Okay. So for both of these applications, you need a very efficient SHG device. Okay. So this is the idea that how important this SHG device may be. The next question is, we understand that SHG device may have a wide application in laser display. Then what's the current technology advance? The development and if the efficient of the laser the SHG device is sufficient for laser display. To answer this question, we should look at the how high the efficiency SHG device can be obtained. To do so, we have to start from original coupled equation. The reason is because in above some discussion, we assume that E omega, in other words, fundamental light will not deplete, in other words, will not change. But if the efficiency, conversion efficiency is very high, you can't ignore the decrease of the fundamental light because the efficiency is very high. You basically have to follow the energy conservation. Okay, the SHG power comes from the fundamental power. Okay, you can't assume that the fundamental power will not change if the efficiency is very high. For this reason, we have to consider these two coupled equations together. And actually, if you consider these two equations together, and after some parameter replacement, you still can obtain an analytical expression, which is given by these equations. Okay, so this equation basically gives you the idea of how the fundamental light will change. And the second equation will give you how the SHG light will change. So if you look at the solution of these two waves, you'll find that both of them can be described by the harmonic function. And it will be interesting to look at the function term, the power of SHG and the fundamental depth as a function of the device length or the input power. Okay, that. So x-axis that you can consider is the input power or intensity of the device length. Okay, that. And this is the power of either the fundamental and the 2 omega. Okay, that. If you plot the mu dot, you will find that the power of fundamental will greatly decrease. And on the other hand, you'll find that the SH power will greatly increase. Okay. And actually, if you look at this point, the conversion efficiency is 100%. Okay, so this is great. So you can, in principle, develop a device with 100% conversion efficiency. Okay. So usually, people think that nonlinear device It's a low efficient device. Okay, that you need a lot of input power. Okay, that for certain that from certain aspect, it's true that because you need a laser beam with a very strong. But if you properly design that device and choose the proper material that, and after certain that the threshold, you can reach the conversion efficiency of 100%. And I can tell you that experimentally, in my lab, we have already demonstrated the combustion efficiency over the 85%. And we're targeting to achieve that over 90%. Okay. So, in other words, it's possible, really possible, to achieve very efficient SHE device if you choose that device and parameter properly. So, in the following discussion, I'm going to give you some ideas on the how this phase matching affect the conversion efficiency. So this basically is the slide indicates that the sync function term I just showed you in the solution of the SHE power as a function of the data key phase mismatching. As you can see that if you find a condition with data key zero, code zero, this is the phase matching condition. Then this term, as I mentioned, reached 1. This is the maximum effect. Okay. On the other hand, if you cannot choose a proper data key or cannot achieve the data phase matching, then you see the power will significantly decrease. Okay. Even decrease to 0. If you don't can't find a proper data key phase matching condition. Okay. So this basically is called the sync function. So this slide basically tell you how important the phase matching condition will be. And the next question is how to achieve the phase matching. Okay, so there are a number of ways to achieve the phase matching. The first way is to use the so-called type 1 phase matching, and second way is called type 2. So let me give you some ideas how to achieve the data type 1 and type 2 respectively. And to do so, I have to repeat this data key again. And you can find by yourself, I think, very easily that in the case of the SHE, the data case is given, is proportional to okay, N2 omega minus N omega. Okay, so in other words, refract index at the harmonic signal and refract index at the omega. And our target is to try to find a condition so that this be zero. And here's the question to you. If we don't do anything, can we achieve this condition? Anyone can answer the question? Apparently not. And the reason is very simple. Because if you look at recall your memory, as I mentioned yesterday, this is typical dispersion curve of refract index. So with the increase of the wavelength, the refracting index will decrease slightly. So if you indicate your wavelength here, usually this is lambda omega, and this is lambda 2 omega. So absolutely, N2 omega is larger than N omega. So if you don't do anything, by no way, you can achieve the phase matching condition. However, don't forget that we are dealing with the crystal. Crystal is an anisotropic medium. So in other words, we can use the ordinary wave and the extraordinary and combination of these two waves. Then we may be able to achieve the phase matching condition so that N2 omega equal to. So let me show you some examples here. So for example, if we can find the crystal, so that for 2 omega signal, we use extraordinary wave. And for the omega signal, we use the ordinary wave. Okay, then you see that this equation can be satisfied. So in other words, phase match condition can be achieved. Okay, so this is the very smart way to do so. Or we can use a different combination. Say that for the fundamental light, we use both ordinary and extraordinary wave. And for SHE wave, we can use the extraordinary wave. Then you see that you can still achieve this phase matching condition. Okay, so For these two situations, we call this a type 1 and a type 2 phase matching corresponding. Okay, and of course, in the real crystal, you really need to look at this index lipstick. So that's why I mentioned that index lipstick is very useful for the tool. So this is the optical axis I introduced yesterday. Okay, basically, in the case of the lipstick, it's the z axis. Okay, and if you look at the index, the refract index as a function of the angle of your incident beam, so which is indicated by the theta m here in this slide, and you'll find that basically that this curve tells you the refract index of fundamental light, and this curve tells you the fundamental light the 2 omega signal, and it's the ordinary wave. Okay, you can see that there's a cross point here. Okay, at this point, refract index are the same, even though although one is ordinary wave, one another is a extraordinary wave. Of course, you can use this point, and this point. Okay, so from this figure, you can find that it's true that we do that can easily, relatively easily find a phase matching condition by choosing the proper signal or the cutting of the crystal. And mathematically, basically, as I mentioned, for ordinary waves, the refract index is the same. And for extraordinary waves, you can use this equation to find the refract index at the 2 omega. Then you just assume that the 2 omega the refract index extraordinary wave is equal to the omega signal at the ordinary wave. Then you can find the theta angle of the incident beam that you should design. And usually the incident beam should be perpendicular to the surface of the crystal. So in other words, once you decide the incident angle of the input beam, then you should be able to decide the cutting surface of your crystal. Okay, so this is the general procedure to decide the phase matching the condition for different things. So when you say that in the future you want to buy a crystal, okay, and to achieve certain say the SAG, then you have to make sure that what wavelengths you are looking for. Okay, so different wavelengths may have different phase matching condition. Okay, so you have to consult with the manufacturer and let them know which wavelength you're looking for. Then they will provide you the proper crystal with the proper cutting so that your beam can incident into the crystal perpendicularly. Okay. So this is the procedure of achieving the phase matching for the traditional crystal. And actually, the incidence angle or phase matching angle has been done, calculated by others as well. So this table shows you how to achieve the phase matching condition for different crystals. And basically, different crystals may have different point group. And you can easily find the phase matching angle through this. So this basically is the first way to achieve the phase matching. And in the following discussion, I'm going to mention a couple of words about another method to achieve the phase matching called the quasi phase matching technique. Okay, so this technique is quite different from the technique I just mentioned. Basically, in the previous technique, you rotate the crystal, right? Change the crystal angle and do the cutting. And in this cross phase matching or QPM technique, we use a very smart idea, as I mentioned in later the discussion. So for example, without QPM, and you have a piece of crystal, okay, and if you look at the phase angle of the generated SA signal, phase angle is proportional to the propagation distance. Okay, so this can be easily understood through the plane wave expression. So let's say that the light or SA signal generated at this point, and SA signal generated at this point, which corresponds to the phase difference, pi phase difference. You see that will propagate along the crystal in this way, indicated by blue and red respectively. And these two beams will interfere with each other at the end of the crystal. Okay, then what happened? You have two beams with a pi phase difference. So what's the result? They will cancel with each other. Okay, then interfere destructively. Okay, then. As a result, the out beam contributed from these two points will be zero. Similarly, you have second point and with the pi phase difference and another point, and these two will cancel with each other as well. So as a whole, at the end of crystal, you get nothing because of this cancellation interference. Okay. So this is why the phase matching is very important. I just give you the brief explanation about phase matching. And however, if you somehow change the phase of this region, okay, this region corresponds to the phase of pi to 2 pi. Okay, you change the phase by pi or add the pi phase difference. Okay, then what happens? These signals are generated as usual, and the signal generated at this point will be reversed or added by pi phase difference. Now you have 0 phase and 2 pi phase. Then these two beams interfere with each other and the edge gets constructed. As a result, you get much larger the output of the SHG signal. So this is the basic, the simple idea of the cross phase matching. Okay, and let's see theoretically what's the result you can obtain. Okay, so this is the result y-axis is the HG intensity and the x-axis is the propagation distance of device length. Okay, as you can see that without phase matching, your signal will oscillate this way, never increase with the increase of the device length. That's why you can't achieve the very high efficiency. However, if you can use the cross phase matching condition, then what you obtain is that you change slightly the oscillation, but in principle, increase with the increase of the device length. Actually, the mathematical analytical solution indicates that the intensity of the SHG light is proportional to the square of the device length, which is the same as the perfect phase matching condition. Okay, so that's why this is a very useful technique and relatively easy to be achieved. And why I think that this is a very useful technique and easily to achieve? Because in this case, if you want to achieve the phase matching at different wavelengths, what you need to do? You simply change the period of the grid. Okay, so it's just simple, very simple. Okay, so also you can achieve the multiple phase matching in a single device because you can generate different segments of the device with different period. Okay, so this is the reason why this device has received a significant significant attention these days. And the result I just mentioned, over the 85% conversion efficiency actually is based on this device. And the next question is, okay, we understand that we need to introduce pi phase shift to the crystal so that the phase that can be pi phase shift, the pi phase can be added to the certain region. And how to increase the pi phase shift into the crystal. And actually, this is very easy in the case of the listen nabate. Because this is the crystal structure of the listen nabate. Okay, and this small dot indicates the listen, And actually, there are two equally stable position for the listen. Okay, the steam could stay either at this position or at this position in the crystal. Okay, so as a result, if you look at the crystal with the lithium at this position, the internal polarization spontaneous polarization is along this direction. And if you put the lithium at this position, and the internal spontaneous polarization is along this direction. So we know that the spontaneous polarization direction decides the sign of the chi 2. Okay, then. So in other words, in one structure shaft, you have plus chi 2, chi 2, and in another structure shaft, you have minus chi 2. Okay, then. So what does this mean? Minus chi 2, basically that, equal to the pi phase shift. Okay, then. And so this is the basic idea to that, how to increase pi phase shift into this region. So in other words, I think that you know the structure now, device structure now. Okay, then. So you only need to reverse the polarization direction of the crystal in certain region. Okay, so that in that region, the pi phase shift can be introduced. Okay, then. And how to do this? And this is a very standard procedure. So basically, you have a piece of that is in 9 bit, and you do the photoresistor, photoresistor, and you leave a certain period here. Okay. And in this region, you apply a very high electric field in this region. Okay. And originally, the spontaneous polarization direction is indicated here, from bottom to up. Okay. And in this region, you apply a very strong electric field in this region. Okay, then the polarization direction can be reversed. And basically, you move to the mesonium position from one position to another. Okay, then. And then you can easily achieve the structure like this, indicated like this. Okay, then. So in this region, this is the original the polarization, and from bottom up, the spontaneous polarization. And in this green region, the polarization direction from top to bottom. Okay, then. So this is the periodic structure. And you can easily achieve this periodic structure by using the crystal polling technique. Okay, then. And as a result, you can reverse or introduce pi phase shift in this green region. And as a result, you can achieve the very high efficiency of the device. So in the above discussion, basically I gave you some rough idea on the SSG device and the principle of this device, and I gave you the two kind of solutions, and one is the assumption of the non-deprecation solution. Basically, I assume that fundamental light is a fundamental light power remain constant, and in this case, and the SSG can be achieved, but the efficiency shouldn't be that high because the efficiency the power the fundamental power remain constant. The second type of solution is I consider a depletion of fundamental power. And as a result, it's possible that all the energy of the fundamental light can be converted to the SSG signal. The efficiency can be as high as 100%. And I mentioned that practically, we have developed several devices, and SSG device with very high efficiency. So this is the first part of the SSG, and I just skipped several slides because I think that it may be easy to go move forward quickly. So should I stop here?
This would be good.
Okay. Talking about SSG, the simplest and but the most important nonlinear effect. And as you can see that the by proper design of the device and the experimental scheme, you can reach really very high nonlinear SSG efficiency. And also I think that the key ideas of the nonlinear device, the nonlinear optics device involved, we all included in the SSG device, specifically the phase matching the idea. And the next question I'm going to answer is how to measure nonlinear coefficient, and for example, in this case, the second harmonic coefficient, the chi 2. And as I mentioned, that to get the full understanding about the chi 2, you need to measure the 27 elements. And by using the crystal symmetric property, you can reduce a certain number of the elements, but you still need to do many experiments to decide. And also, if you want to measure nonlinear coefficient, you face the problem of measure the power of light precisely. And actually, this is not the easy work, even though it sounds easy. And because, as I mentioned in the experiment, you have many components, and you have the detection image of your the power meter and the calibration of your power meter, etc. As a result, people usually use so-called Mach fringe technique to measure the nonlinear coefficient. And the idea is use the reference material which has a known nonlinear coefficient, and you just compare the your measured sample, the SH signal, with this the reference sample. And then, since you know the nonlinear coefficient of the reference sample, then if you know the ratio of the SH signal, and if you use the same experiment setup, then you should be able to decide the nonlinear coefficient of your sample. So this is the basic idea in measuring the nonlinear coefficient. So it's a mathematical expression is given by this equation. And as you can see that, if you know the reference sample, and also you have your sample data here, then basically you should be able to measure the effective chi2. And if you know the ratio of experiment to the SH power. So this is the basic idea. And experiment setup is also very simple. Basically, you just insert your sample into your system, and of course, you don't want to detect the fundamental light. You have to use the filter to filter out the fundamental light, only to measure the power of the SH signal. And this is experimental setup, experimental results. As you can see that the SH relative, the ratio of SH power as a function of the rotation of your crystal is indicated here. So as you can see that those are the experimental results. The curve is fitting. And you can, by using this, you can decide the chi2 or the effective nonlinear coefficient by using this fitting method. And this is the quite usually, widely used technique in determining the SH signal, or SH nonlinear coefficient. And of course, when you after you measure the SH signals, SH signal from your sample, you have to insert your reference sample precisely at the same position and do the same experiment. Okay, and this slide shows you the measured experiment, measured the SH or chi2 signal, chi2 the nonlinear coefficient. So as you can see that the nonlinear coefficient depends on the wavelength you're working at. And also if you take the look at the nonlinear coefficient at the same wavelength, you can see that mismatch has the largest number of value of the coefficient. So that's why the mismatch is widely used as the nonlinear device, simply because the nonlinear coefficient is much larger than the others. So if you look at the SHG, the power analytical expression, you find that the SH power efficiency is proportional to square of the nonlinear coefficient. So in fact, the nonlinear coefficient has a significant impact on the SH signal, as you can see. And interesting thing is that for the gallium arsenide, the nonlinear coefficient is very high, okay, order of the higher than the other material. However, it's very hard to use the gallium arsenide as a nonlinear the optical device or second harmonic device, generation device. The reason is mainly because the phase matching condition. Okay, it's very hard to achieve the phase matching condition for the gallium arsenide. And as a result, the SHG signal is not that strong. So a lot of work, research work, focusing on developing the coarse phase matching QPM device based on the gallium arsenide. But it needs a lot of work. And currently, I think the significant progress in developing the middle-infrared light generation based on the gallium arsenide, which has a very important application in military and environment monitoring. So I'm not going to touch this in detail, but I just mentioned that gallium arsenide is a very important and interesting material. Okay, so I would like to move forward to the SFG, sum of frequency generation. So if you understand the SHG, I think that for SFG and DFG will be much easier to be understood. So basically, the SFG is the process decided by this coupled equation. So if you compare the coupled equation with the SFG, basically the very little neat difference, because SFG can be considered a special case for SFG. E1 and E2 are the same in this case. And of course, in this case, you need to solve at least a two coupled equation. Because even though you assume that E3, your pump light, is a constant, and so you still need to solve this first two, the coupling equation. And of course, you can assume that both E1 and E2 are constant. Then you only need to solve one equation, which is given by this expression. So if you compare this expression with the SHU one, and actually they're very much similar. And just give you some idea. So this is the SFG signal. Okay, and if you can want to obtain the high efficiency of the SFG, you need to increase the device length proportional to the square of the device length. Also, you need to satisfy so-called phase match condition. So this is sync function. Okay, so data k should be zero. Okay, so the phase matching, as mentioned, emphasize again, is very important. And also, you need to find the proper crystal design or configuration so that D effect is larger. And of course, you need to provide the strong input I1 and I2 respectively. Okay, so as you can see the SFG under this assumption is very similar to SFG. And here I think there's the similar thing for the SFG as well. So you need to achieve the so-called the phase matching condition. Data k should be zero. And if you look at the expression of data k, it's given by this equation. Because in this case, omega 1 and omega 2 are different. So actually, this might be not best thing, good thing. We can use this as the advantage of the SFG, because you have more flexibility. And you can change the polarization direction of the E1 and the E2, okay, respectively. Okay. And you can change the refracting index of E1 and E2. You have a combination of E1 and E2 as well. So you see that. But anyway, the bottom line is that you have to satisfy the phase match condition to achieve the high convolution efficiency. And if you want to consider the case of the high convolution efficiency, as I mentioned, the pump power non-depletion the assumption has to be removed. In other words, you have to use the three coupled equation, and you have to consider the E3 as well. Okay, so if this is the case, so you can do some replacement. Say you can assume the K1, capital K1, K2, and the K3. And then you can also do some replacement, and as we did for SHG. Then you can obtain the much simplified expression of the SHG the question. So before that, I want to mention this very interesting formula here. So this, if you look at this, the first term basically the intensity of the E1, and second term the E2 and the E3 respectively. So if you add them together, it's divided by the W, it's a constant. Okay, in this equation. So in other words, the energy conservation is always satisfied, and also it seems that the energy transfers from one wave to another. Okay. So this equation gives us, because the summation of these three energy of the three wavelengths and remains constant. Okay, so it gives you some simulation results shown here. Okay, so this result shows how the E1, E2, and the E3 change. Okay. So in this case, we assume that the E3 has the much higher power. E1 has much higher power than E2. So it's about 100 times. Okay, larger than E2. Okay, so the E1 is the same the one. So as a function of the device propagation the device length, the E1 almost remains constant. Okay, and if you look at the E2, okay, E2 is decreased from maximum to minimum, And E3 increase from zero to maximum. And then decrease. So it seems that the energy is transferred between E2 and E3. Okay, so that this actually is exactly what this expression, this equation means. Okay, so this equation actually is the well-known called the Mandelbrot relationship. Okay, so different from a little different from the SHG case. Okay, in the case of SHG, your fundamental light will decrease to zero, and SHG to increase to maximum. Okay, in this case, you see that if you assume the E1 as a constant, and E2 and E3, they basically the transfer energy between each other, which is very interesting. And of course, you can do some parameter replacement, and then you can simplify your coupled equation in this case, in this way. And of course, you can obtain the analytical solution, which is given by this equation. Okay, so of course, to do so, you have to make some assumption. For example, in this case, you have to assume that E1 is the power of E1 is much larger than E2. Then you can get a much simplified the analytical solution, which is just mentioned. So if you look at this the analytical solution, basically there's somehow I think this should be the hyperbolic sine function. I think there's something mistake. I think. So anyway, I think this is the result of the three waves. And for practical application, I emphasize again that we need to consider this effective nonlinear coefficient, which is given by the direction decided by the polarization direction of E1 and E2, and also the polarization direction of E3 you want to obtain as a signal. And also that in the case of the QPM structure, you can obtain the similar structures. And in this case, you only need to mention about the D effective in this case. And so potential applications are for the SFG. So as I mentioned, basically the SFG idea is that you have lambda 1 and lambda 2, and you create you generate lambda 3. So in other words, you can get shorter wavelengths from longer wavelengths. So you have lambda 1 and lambda 2, and you generate lambda 3. Okay, so in other words, you have omega 1 plus omega 2 and equal to omega 3. Okay. So this is the SFG. And as I mentioned, by using this technique, you can obtain shorter wavelengths. And many applications, for example, in the case of the SHG, you input one single beam and you get a shorter wavelength. So in this case, you can input two longer wavelengths and get a shorter one. Okay. So that you have more flexibility. You know? Because as mentioned in the spectrum, the semiconductor laser diode, available semiconductor laser diode is very limited. Okay, and if you have more combination, okay, then you can have the more new wavelengths at short wavelengths. Okay, so this is the reason why the SHG is also a very important device. But of course, you need to input two light beams, and in return, you have more flexibility. You have more flexibility in choosing or generating new wavelengths, and more flexibility in the design and the phase matching condition. Okay, that's the adventure of the SHG. Okay, then I will spend a little time on different frequency generation. And for the different frequency generation, this is also the second order nonlinear effect. And again, we have to start from the Maxwell equation. And this is a coupled equation you can use for the different frequency generation. So if you look at compare this coupled equation with SFG, they are precisely the same, and nothing different. Okay, the only difference is the input. Okay, in this case, your input is E3 and E1. Okay, you have or you can have E2. Okay, so this is the DFG. So you have a shorter wavelengths. You have shorter wavelengths, and that you have the longer wavelengths input as an input. You need two input, and then you get a relatively long wavelengths. Okay, so this is the process for DFT. And of course, solve this couple of equations, you need a little bit of assumption to get the analytical solution. Of course, if you just use the computer, and you can get a numerical solution as well. So for example, if you assume that E3 is a constant, the pump is a constant, then you only need to solve these two coupled equations. Then you can relatively easy to get analytical solution. Again, in this analytical solution, you'll find that you need a phase match condition, satisfy the phase match condition, and also that you need to use the relatively longer device, the longer device. And also you need to choose the proper the nonlinear coefficient of the design of the crystal, and also you need to provide a large input so that you can get a high DFG signal. Okay, so which is similar to the SHG case. Okay. And in terms of this, length of the device, I would like to mention a couple of words. And there's two ways to achieve a longer device. Okay, then. The first way is that I use a long device. Okay, then. I just use a long device here. Like that. So this is the device length. Of course, you can do this because according to this equation, the longer the device and the high efficiency you can achieve. However, practically, you have to keep in mind that we need a pump light. We need a lens, and we need a pump light. Okay, then. So if you recall your memory about the geometric the optics, if you use the lens here, and you want to keep this the beam diameter as small as possible, and also you want to keep the beam diameter as uniform as possible within the crystal, then if the crystal is too long, that causes a problem. Okay, then, because it's hard to achieve. It's a longer working distance. And as a result, people that create the smart ideas. You use a relatively small device. Okay, then. And you still use the lens, for example, here. Okay, then you can focus the beam. Okay, then. Then you create a resonator here. Okay, then. Then you see that the beam will go in the force for many rounds or trip. And effectively, you can achieve a very long device. Okay, so this is the technique people usually use. So this is a resonance structure, okay, or cavity structure of the SHG device. So in this case, we call it extra cavity configuration. In this case, we call it intra cavity configuration. Okay, so basically, for SHG device, there's two setup configuration, extra two. And intra cavity. Okay, then of course, if you want to solve the coupling equation in more general fashion, then of course you can do this. And you just need to do some replacement about the parameters, and you can obtain the solution given by this equation. Okay, so of course, these equations are obtained on the assumption that E3, the pump light, is dominant. It's much stronger than E2. Okay, so this is the case. And in more general cases, you can obtain the solution given by this. Okay, so actually, the reason I pick up this solution is that even though it looks very complex, but give us some idea how the OPA works, okay, the optical parametric amplifier works. Actually, I'm talking about not just the converted signal, okay, the converted generate new signal, and also this is the second harmonic, second order device can be used as amplifier, okay. And how it works, I just show you the example here. So we have very strong E3 power, pump power. Keep this in mind. Then these are the expression for E1 and E2. Okay, E2 could be the input as well. Okay, and or you put E1 as well in this case. Then what happened? If you look at the solution are given by the Photonic functions. And if you look at this, you see that there's a small parameter called G here, and the gamma is given by the proportional to the power of the pump power. And K kappa 1 and kappa 2 correspond to the, it's a constant parameter and decided by the nonlinear coefficient. Anyway, the parameters there. And then you see that if you look at this term, interesting thing is if you can achieve the phase matching condition, delta K is zero, this value, this root squared will be the root, will be the real value. Okay, there. If this is real value, if you look at this Hee-Tae cosine function, which is given by the so if you look at this function, okay, then if x is a positive value, okay, then what happens? And you increase the device length L, okay, then in other words, if you increase the number value of x, let's say that x increases to the infinite value, then this cosine function will reach a very large value. Okay, then. In other words, you can achieve the very high than that, E1 or E2. Okay, then. So this is very important. So in other words, you provide a very small input of your E1 or E2. Then this both E1 and E2 will experience amplification process. Okay, this is significant. Okay, then. And this actually can be used as a laser or amplifier. Okay, then. So that's why it is an OPO device is widely used and in industry because this effect. Okay, and the next question is, okay, if practically, if it's possible to make this term impossible, okay, the answer definitely is yes, I show you that, because if you can choose the proper phase matching condition, delta K is zero, or coarse phase matching condition, delta K will be very small value, then if you can increase the pump power E3, then this term definitely can be a positive value. Okay, so this is the goal to achieve the very high the gain. And actually, by using this the OPA technique, experiments that people have demonstrated that the gain as high as 60 dB can be achieved. So if you work in the industry of the telecom, I think that EDFA, the urban dot fiber amplifier, okay, the typical gain is 20 to 30 dB. Okay, but if you use the nonlinear crystal, okay, and properly design the crystal and choose the proper condition, and you actually can achieve 6 dB. Okay, so you know, so the 10 dB is 10 times, 20 dB is 100 times. Okay, 30 dB, 60 dB, you can imagine how large the amplification to the coefficient may be. And also very importantly, for EDFA, typically the bandwidth of the amplification is only about say 30 nanometer, right? So this is the main limitation of the communication bandwidth. Okay, and but using the OPA, you can achieve even the 200 nanometers bandwidth. Okay, easily, which is significant. Okay, so therefore, there are many researchers that are focusing on this, developing this new amplifier. Okay, which is really which has very high the amplification coefficient and also the bandwidth. So as you can see, by using the second order nonlinear device, you can in principle achieve this. Okay, but you need to design the device properly. And in the following slides, I want to give you the sometimes the idea on the application of telecom based on the DFG device. Okay, so you know in the telecom, people are working on WDM. In the WDM, the cross section, the cross connector is the ideal system. So in this system, you need the space switch and the wavelength converter as well. So basically, the wavelength converter needs to be the variable in, variable out. Any wavelength in and any wavelength out. And simply the control the electric field or the input to control the signal. And we need the optical wavelength converter or wavelength switcher. So currently, telecom system looks like this. You have a highway. I think that you're much familiar with the highway. Okay, the highway, and you have different lane. And if you find some traffic in front of you, you simply switch lane, and the highway can move forward smoothly. But the current telecommunication networks look like this. You have many lanes, which is indicated by the wavelength or the channel of the wavelength, but it's not allowed to be switched between the different wavelengths. Okay, in other words, you can't switch the channel. Okay, it's very hard to do so. And especially when we talk about the 10 gigahertz or 40 gigahertz per second communication system. And the people need all optic high wavelength converters, which can be operated at very high speed. So this kind of the optical wavelength converters or switches can increase the demand for internet bandwidth significantly, I believe. And also reduce the complexity of the network management. And also we need some kind of requirement. For example, first, the high efficiency, the switch, we don't want the signal to suffer some loss in this switch. So ideally, the 0 dB, 100% conversion would be the ideal. And also the transparency, the bit rate and the data format must be transparent. So it shouldn't depend on the bit rate and the data format. And also the polarization should be insensitive and the low cost, the broadband, etc. So we can use this so-called QPM device. Okay, so I just mentioned. So for example, this is the QPM device based on the Listen 98, and I mentioned we can generate this kind of the periodic domain inversion structure, and we can introduce the waveguides in this structure to increase the conversion efficiency. The waveguides basically is to increase the intensity of the light wave. As I mentioned, in nonlinear optics, intensity plays an important role. Okay. And why this device can be used as an optical wavelength converter and signal. Because you have a DFG device here, and you have the optical signal, the digital signal. And you have a pump here, and basically the pump and signal will generate the DFG signal. We call this the converter signal. Okay. And for example, if your pump is located at 0.77 micrometer, and your signal is 1.55 micrometer, then their converter signal is around 1.53 micrometer, which is also for within the communication channel. Okay, and if your pump is 1.71, and you can switch the channel between 155 to 1.31, different window. Okay, so in other words, this device can either be used within the communication band or between the different communication band. Okay, so as I mentioned, two conditions must be satisfied. First, energy conservation, and that's true, and decide the conversion signal wavelength. And second, the QPM condition. Okay, so the high efficiency. So this is the prototype device we developed. And the device, typical device length is 4.5 centimeter, and the insertion loss, including the coupling and the waveguide the propagation loss, is about 4 dB, which is very small. And the efficiency can be as high as 280% per watt. So for example, these are sometimes the experimental results. So for example, you have this is the fixing the variable out wavelength convert. So in other words, your input signal is fixed at this wavelength, but your output signal can be changed. So as you can see that you have the, you can consider this as a pump, and the, this is the signal, and you can convert it to another channel. And in terms of efficiency, as I mentioned, ideally the 0 dB, 100% conversion efficiency will be ideal. So let's see the theoretically if it's possible. And this figure shows you the conversion efficiency. I consider the fiber coupling loss in this simulation. And the x-axis is the device length. As you can see that, if you have, say, the 5 device length between the 4 and the 5, you can in principle achieve the 0 dB efficiency. And also you can use the other mechanism, say cascade mechanism, with a little bit longer device to achieve the 0 dB conversion efficiency. Okay. So currently this device, the experiment, actually the parametric gain has been obtained, plus 1 dB has been achieved, okay, by using the pump power of only the 200 milliwatts, okay, which is significant, I think. So basically these are the brief introduction about the SHG device and SFG device and the device, the DFG device as well. So as you can see that in this lecture I basically give you some rough idea about this three process, and mainly give you some idea on the potential application of these devices. Of course, there's many other potential applications. For example, and the parametric down conversion, okay, which is very important in quantum computation, because sometimes you need to generate a quantum pair, okay, the integral to the quantum pair, and by using the parametric down conversion, you can easily achieve this type of conversion. But the key here is the efficiency, and to achieve the efficiency, a high efficiency, you need the phase matching and the proper design of the device. Okay, thank you very much.
Are there questions? Yes, please. Could you go back to the page showing your defense, which is on the fiber phase?
Which page?
The next page.
Next page?
Yeah.
Okay.
No. The page showing your 4.5 cm device.
Which page?
This one.
This one? Okay.
No.
That one.
Next one?
Back. Previous.
This one?
So do you need any temperature control on your device? Because I know that for the pre-pin, there should be some temperature control using an oven.
Yes, we're talking about the optics of the devices. So basically the control signal is the optics as well. So basically we use the pump as a control. So you see, this is a DFG device. We need two beams incident into the device. One is omega 3, another is omega 2. Omega 2 is a signal, and omega 3 can consider as a control. So we don't need to apply to any electric field or electric voltage on the device.
No, I mean some temperature control.
Temperature control, that's a good question, actually. So for the QPM devices, usually the temperature tolerance is not that large. But in this case, the temperature tolerance is about 10 degrees. So that depends on your working condition. So if my working environment can be controlled within 10 degrees, and you don't need the temperature control. But in our case, we didn't use the temperature control because we worked in the laboratory environment, and the temperature definitely should be within 10 degrees.
And
I have
a follow-up question. And how you're using a bulb inside your device, and how do you couple your light between
the... We didn't use a bark, we used the waveguide structure. Yes.
So how do you couple the light from the waveguide to your fiber?
So you just bring a piece of fiber and cover the fiber with the waveguide. We didn't use the lens in particular. So the joint the butt cutter in coupling the techniques.
Is there more questions? Yes.
Can you comment on what pulse width, loss energy, and repetition rate that you're using there? I didn't see the numbers.
Okay, then. So for example, in this case, the pulse width, I think, is in a nanosecond. In terms of the parts of the energy, I don't recall my memory, but every power is around the 1 to 5 milliwatts. Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
More questions? Yes.
Yes.
I was curious to know about the very low efficiency in parametric down converter. Because as you show that other nonlinear effects have efficiency something like 90% you call you achieved 8. But in parametric down converter it is very low, like 10 to the power minus 6. So
yes.
What is the cause behind that?
Yeah, so usually we have to consider the phase machine the condition. Okay, so in the case of the SAG, as I mentioned, you have to the high efficiency can be obtained in the condition that you have sufficient amount of device. Okay, and the 85% or even higher the conversion efficiency is obtained under the cavity structure. Okay, so you have effectively a very long device. Okay. And on the other hand, for parametric down conversion, I'm not sure if you are using the waveguide structure. Okay, if you use the waveguide structure, you can use relatively long device. So otherwise, if you just use the bar, due to the limitation of the optical setup and device length, typically is about 10 millimeter, which is very short. Okay, and that's the main reason. And also, I'm not sure if you have achieved the phase matching condition. If not, the efficiency will be very low. Yeah.
Are there more questions? If not, let us thank our speaker again.